You know those people that make you want a front kick? That's you guys. You guys make me want to do a front kick. Hey, can we give it up for the band real quick, the team this morning? Come on. I said this last service. One of the best things, like my favorite things about John, is he just picks the things up that people say. And so as a Southern Indiana boy, we always just say, come on. And he said, come on, like 20 times. 20 times this morning. Come on. Can y'all say it? Come on.
Come on.
If Bo's around, he says it a little different. I'm not even going to try. Not even going to try. He's back there going, what do I do? He, come on. I can't even do it. It is so good to be with you guys, man. It's so good to be here. Brad took a little break, did a little shoulder tap, which I love to do this. When time allows, I love to do this. And it's just so good because what I get to see on the side of the room is a team that's growing here. How about the little kid that's up here, Danny? The little girl. We love Danny, and it's an ongoing joke. He looks like he's 12, but he's not. I think he's 19. Right, Danny? 18 or 19. He is an adult, believe it or not, people. And we love him with all of our hearts. It is New Series Sunday. We're kicking off a new series, like Brooke said, like John said, called Reflections. And I'm super excited about this because, man, I think that if we get this right, a lot of things are going to shift and we're going to see immediate change. Not down the road, but immediate change and payoff. In this series, we're going to talk about how we see ourselves often dictates how we behave. And then we're going to ask ourselves, are we accurately seeing ourselves intentionally and in truth? Now, for those of you that call Agape City your home, you know that we value a couple things. We value loving like Jesus and biblical truth. And so for me, this is super exciting. Love like Jesus, biblical truth, not our version of, not our parents' version of, not the world's version of, not our best friend's version of, but God's word and his version of. And so I'm super excited to unpack this, to be the one that opens up the series. How many of you were here last week? Raise your hand. Yeah, okay. All right. Some of you weren't. A lot of you were. If you weren't here last week, do yourself a favor. Go watch the sermon from last week. Go watch the message specifically. Because what we had, I believe it was a memorable moment in time for us as a church where and this goes against everything that I've ever learned. I'm not kidding you guys about ministry. We had three people hop up and give their testimony unproduced, not put in a box, with a microphone that was unmuted. And it went awesome. It didn't go off the rails. It went great. Yeah, go ahead. Let's give it up for Mike, Courtney, and Jason. You know, all three of them, man, they left us with something so precious. Every one of us has a story, and we should be telling it. What is your before Jesus story? Man, start to put that together. Start to take the time when you sit with Jesus to write that down and go share that with other people, what your journey has looked like. It's just powerful, and it moves our faith up a notch. All right, let's dive in. Here we go. When Brad first dreamed up this idea of reflections, and he was talking about us being in James, I'm like, oh man, how many James fans do we have? Like, I love James, right? Because it's all of the things that I feel like Tim needs to be reminded of that he doesn't do so well and he needs to work on. And so for me, I constantly like a challenge. If you know me well, I can't stand still. I'm always busy. I can get bored pretty easily. So I actually enjoy hearing, hey, when trials come, consider it pure joy. Well, why is that? I'd love to unpack why you would like me to be happy, Lord, in this moment. And then even what we're going to talk about today, like I love this stuff. But I think this is probably one of my favorite things about this series is that most of the time, if you're like me, when we read the word, right, we'll read something and we'll scratch our heads like, man, how does that apply today? How do I practically take that to this world, to my community, to the people that I work with, where I go to school, whatever it may be for you? And we ask God to give us a practical way to unpack it. James is just written for today. It just is. It is, when I look at this, I know it was written thousands of years ago, but what I'm talking about is it is the things that he is talking about are happening in our world today, which is why we must get this right. Are you with me? If you have your Bible or Bible app, you can follow along. If you didn't bring either of those, we're going to be in James chapter 1. verse 19. And if you didn't bring either of those, you can follow along on the screen. Thank God for our media team. I need to brag on them just for a minute. Give them a high five. Listen, this is Jen, her daughter Grace is back there. And this is what I want to just take a moment to do real quick, because we fly over this stuff in church. We just do. We breeze right by it. None of our staff creates any of this stuff. We have a group of volunteers that cares that we go through God's word together, and they put this together. And man, we couldn't do this without you. We love you guys. Thank you so much for everything you do. Some people could look at it like, yeah, but it's just a button. It's way more than a button. Way more than a button. So thank you so much for all you do, media team. You guys rock. All right, let's follow along. Here we go. Jay, bless you. Is that a sneeze? Okay. All right. It sounded like a woohoo. Okay. Thought you were happy. All right, that's good. Oh, man. Okay. James chapter 1, verse 19. Here we go. Ready, set, read. My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry, because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. If you know me, pretty practical dude, when I read scripture, I think I've told you guys this before, my pattern is I have to keep repeating it over and over and over and over and over and over and over, and I try not to move on too quick because I want to understand what the author is saying, but also, this is what I know to be true, that once we hear the word and it enters our mind, the hardest thing to do, we've talked about this before, is that 18 inches from head to heart. And this is why I keep repeating stuff. When you guys read scripture, don't move on so fast. Just keep reading the same thing over and over and over, because what happens is you'll start to write it on your heart. And once you write it on your heart and it stays in your heart, it becomes playable in your life. It's almost like muscle memory. It's why there's so many places in the word when Jesus is saying, I'm the vine, you are the branches, remain in me and I in you, and you will bear much fruit. That's what he's saying. Constantly be doing this thing with me. Constantly be seeking me. Constantly be repeating the things and writing them on your heart. And so what I did here in this first piece was, I'm going to read it again. And then what I like to do is, when I read scripture and I repeat and I repeat and I repeat, then I write it out in a way that makes sense for Tim. I use words that make sense for Tim. Again, I'm a pretty simple dude. So we'll do that in just a minute. But I'm going to read it again, and then we're going to give you what Brad likes to call the TKV, the Tim Keiser version. We're going to give you that. We're going to read the NIV, then we'll get to the TKV, okay? Here we go. Let's read it one more time. My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry, because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. TKV, here we go. Christ followers, this is more important than you could ever imagine. Each of you should have the reputation of one that is slow to speak and quick to listen, a spiritual maturity in you that isn't easily angered when you hear something that you don't like or agree with, a life that reflects Christ and constantly produces righteousness, the perseverance and discipline to resist all of the evil things that are accepted, practiced, and favored right in front of you every day in this world. And at last, planting the roots of your heart, soul, and mind deep in my word. There's nothing different about that, right? We've kept the main thing, but I've just gone through scripture and it makes sense to me. This is a charge, like, you guys, in the beginning, he's saying brothers and sisters. If we read the Bible and we go through, we know who he's talking to, brothers and sisters in Christ. It's the people that call themselves followers of Jesus, Christ followers. And then he tells everybody, as if everybody's bad at taking notes. We've all worked with that person, right? Like, man, I have to tell you, I gotta remind you. He says, take note of this to everyone. Everybody take note of this. You should be quick to listen, slow to speak, slow to become angry, because human anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. Therefore, get rid of all. And he starts to pick apart all the things that the world gives you the thumbs up, that the world gives you the check mark of approval. Get rid of them. They're no good for you. Do these things. I had a mentor, when we talk about listening, I had a mentor on the West Coast. He checked me after one of our big Christmas meetings. And man, if you're like me, how many Christmas people do we have in the room? Come on. Oh, I was hoping for more. You, man. There's a few of us. Bo's jumping in the back. There we go. I'm a huge Christmas freak, man. Like, I love Christmas. It could be Christmas all year long. So when we go into Christmas planning, I get super excited because I love Christmas. And so we're in this meeting. Let me set the scene. We've got this big, you know, round table, if you can imagine, a conference room, you know, style vibe. Big, huge round table, 15 to 20 of us. Again, large church out in West Coast. And we're talking about the Christmas service, and our leader had said, hey, come with your best ideas the next week. And so everybody started doing their thing. They started looking for stuff, and they came back, and they started. So anyway, we get in this room, and where he starts, I'm like almost at the end. And I'm like, man, I just want to share my idea, but I got to listen to all these people first. And so anyway, we're going around, right? We're going around, and it's like, yep. Yep, yep, okay, yep. And if I'm being honest with you, I was listening. I was listening to every other sentence. Because, here's why. Because I was ready to share the obviously most thought out, extravagant Christmas idea that anyone had ever heard in my time. And so I'm just like, hurry up, hurry up, hurry up, get to me, hurry up, hurry up, hurry up, get to me. Vulnerable moment, I'm not teasing. This is how this all went down. This is how my mind works. And so, you know what? We all think like this a little bit, don't we? Yeah. How many of you, yeah, we do. Listen, it's not just me. How many people, when you are praying, all right, we're circled up, everybody's praying, we're holding hands if we're real Jesus followers, and if you're afraid, we don't. Anyway, we're all circled up praying, and we're holding hands because we love each other, and you hear your sister Martha, two people down, pray for the same thing that you were going to pray for, so in your mind, you're not listening anymore, you're switching your prayer up. Everybody does it. Come on. You're not going to pray for the same thing. We all do this. Yeah, I echo that prayer. I echo her prayer. It gets to me. I share the idea. And, you know, people start going around and we're talking about the things. Meeting adjourned. Everybody exits. We're going to come back the next week and we're going to choose whichever one we're doing. And we walk out of the room and my friend, my leader, one of my mentors who has every right to speak into my life and help me make little adjustments to become more like Jesus because he loves Tim. And he says, hey, Tim, real quick, let me catch you. And I was like, yeah, what's going on, Pat? He said, we're going to go with your idea. Everybody seemed excited about it. You seemed very excited about it. And we're going to go and he starts getting into all the things because the story and it does this and all these things are going to enter in at this time and this cue. And he's speaking my language. I'm like, right? Doesn't it make sense? Yeah, isn't it great? And he said, we're going to do it, but I'm a little disappointed. I'm like, I'm so confused right now. Is it a good idea or is it not a good idea? And he said, I'm just a little disappointed. And I'm like, oh, well, dude, we can change. My mind goes to the Christmas meeting. He was like, well, you can change whatever you want to change. I'm not married to my idea. I learned that a long time ago. You marry your idea, you're going to be the one hurt in the end because there's other ideas. And somebody's could be better. And so he says, I'm just disappointed. So we're gonna run the play. The team seems excited, but I'm a little disappointed, man. And I said, well, we can change whatever. Like, whatever you want to change. They don't have to enter there. They can come in at this moment. They can, whatever you want to change. And he said, say that again. And I said, change whatever you want to change, like that part? He was like, yeah. So I can change whatever I want to change. I said, 100%. Change whatever you want. He said, cool. I want to change the way you listen. This was like when we got to Arizona. So I was kind of like, this might be a rough ride. This might be a rough ride. I thought I was doing something good. And this is what he said. I'll never forget it. It plays out still in every one of my relationships today. And I'm so glad he loved me enough to tell me the truth. He said, if I saw Tim in his wheels turning, not sitting still, tapping, doing all the things. If I saw Tim going, hurry up, hurry up, hurry up, just get to me, hurry up, hurry up, hurry up. He said, that's the thing I would want to change. You listened to that entire room just for your chance to respond and you understood no one. And he said, if you have to start, you have to try, Tim. You have to try to start to master this thing called listening. Because in God's word, if you just merely read the word, if you just listen and do nothing with it, you're going to deceive yourself. And now I know what he was talking about. Because this is what James is talking about, and it's to our first point. He said, you need to start to listen to understand, not respond. The thing that you actually want to say isn't important, and you're not going to learn anything anyway with your mouth doing this. And we're having this conversation in a hallway with, you know, it's like, you're doing this, not learning anything. Just listen. Listen to understand where people are coming from. And I think this is the first step to what James is talking about. We have to become good listeners. We have to become good listeners. Let's move on to verse 22. It says, do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Anyone who listens to the word but does not do what it says is like someone who looks at his face in a mirror and after looking at himself goes away and immediately forgets what he looks like. Every one of us read that and go, that's insane. But yet we do it. But whoever looks intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continues in it, not forgetting what they have heard, but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do. Some of you are going, okay, got it. So this is confusing. So we do need to listen. James is telling us to become better listeners than we've ever been before, right? Better listeners. Now you're telling us that don't just listen to the word, but also do the word. Both are true. Both are true. And it isn't one without the other. It never works that way. It's both. It's listen, do. The first two things that stand out to me in this portion of scripture where James is talking is number one, if you just listen, you will deceive yourself. Don't just listen or you will deceive yourself. Number two, stop looking intently to everyone and everything else outside of God's word. Right? Like it just doesn't make sense, but it's so easy to do, isn't it? Like we start talking about a conversation that we might be passionate about. And the next thing you know, we are processing and we are talking about things that have nothing to do with our salvation, that have nothing to do with biblical truth, that have nothing to do. And for me, I'm like, compartmentalize, waste of time. Put this in a box over here. But I need to do some other things. Like I don't have 2 hours to talk about things that don't do, you know what I'm saying? And like today, we love to do this. It ends in debates and then people are upset at each other and it's, what do you think about this? What do you think about that? And we so easily just fall victim to the enemy's trap. And we start looking at people like they're the problem. You're the problem, it's not me. And so we become deceived. I've thought a lot about this in picking this apart and I'm like, man, where does this stem from? I originally thought when I was writing this message, sitting down with Jesus, like, I think it stems from pride. I think it could stem from a little bit of ego, you know? But I think it's actually different than that. I think when I read this scripture, for me, it stems from people wanting to be revered as something. Hey, I want to be respected as. I want to be perceived as. And we go down this dangerous path of name it, claim it. Look anywhere in this world right now and it's going on. It's going on everywhere you look. It doesn't matter where you look. It's going on everywhere, regardless of which way you want to look. I think that I am, and so I'm going to start to behave a certain way. We see this in kids. We see it in even adults. We just anywhere you look. It's there. It's prevalent. It is praised. It is practiced. And this is why this is a message for today. In music, we have this, you know, in the music world, it doesn't matter if it's worship, country, whatever. If you are a professional musician, do you know what you don't say to people? That you're a professional musician. Because the people that you hop on stage with will know by the way that you carry yourself, by the way that you play. Funny stories, and this is from the past. This has never happened here. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. But in the past, we have this thing called, to join this team right up here, we have this thing called an audition process for really good reasons. So an audition process, the things that I'm kind of giving you guys a little inside high five, if you will. The thing that we look for here isn't your playability, like that's a piece of it. Your competency is a piece of it. But we're looking at character. Like, we're going to get time to hang with you. we are gonna look at your competency and your craft and your gift, but we just wanna hang. We wanna know your story. Man, what's life been like for you? How long have you been coming to Agape? Tell us your faith story. Like, do you know who you, like, these things matter to us. And there's been people in the past that, you know, they'll hit me with, they'll find my email or whatever, my church email. It's like, hey man, if you ever need a drummer, if you ever need a bass player, I've been playing for 15 years, don't really need to audition. You don't need to audition? Professionals don't do those kind of things. So when those kind of things are said, it's just like, but professionals don't do that. They just show you with their life. And that's what James is saying. He's saying, don't just listen and merely deceive yourself, but do it as well. Don't tell people that you're going to go feed the homeless down in Detroit. Just go feed the homeless down in Detroit. Don't tell people that you're going to go, just go do it. Right? I think Brooke says something here like, we don't want to just talk about it. We want to be about it. I love that. But it's both. We got to do both. I think one of the best picks, how many of you guys remember American Idol? But go with me here, like old school American Idol. Like young Simon Cowell. The guy was brutal. Like he was brutal. Like when he hit the scene, everybody was like, what is he doing? And I'm back here like, well, a lot of it's just the truth. That's what he's saying. Like all these people have been lied to. I don't know. I love this guy. But as he's gotten older, it's been fun to watch. You got to admit, it's been fun to watch him soften up a little bit. Because at times he could really like tear people down and they walk away like, oh, I'm never going to be anything. But man, I just love this picture and this thought of what we're about to see. Check this out. We'll come back and talk about it.
You can't sing.
Well, I think I can.
But I just think you should give us a chance.
But a chance to do what?
To improve.
Yeah, girls, we have weeks, not decades.
I don't think there's any other voice in the world that can sing like that.
We all agree with that.
Simon, what do you think?
I think it's terrifying, the fact that you are a, you know, maths professor, tutor, whatever you are, and you think that is acceptable. I mean, it's literally terrifying.
Why is it terrifying?
It was a horrific audition. You must know that.
Horrifically good.
Bad.
And you think this is what the winner of X Factor 4 should be like?
Yeah, it shows the joy of life, as far as I can see.
For who?
Not in a billion years. There are only so many words I can drag out of my vocabulary to say how awful that was.
How well do you think you did?
I think I really did great.
Oh.
Can I tell you what I thought, Rosa?
Sure.
Your audition was horrendous.
Horrendous?
Horrendous with a capital H.
Moral of the story, stop lying to people. Stop lying to your kids. It is nice when they come sing to mommy and daddy, but it's like, it's okay. They don't have to be a future singer. People ask us, you know, it's every once in a while I'll get the question, okay, so dad sings. Does anybody else in the house sing? Do you and Tessa sing together? And I'm like, the only thing she plays is the radio. And she can get that sometimes, but she even has to like preset stuff because we don't sing together. She doesn't want to do that because she knows. But she knows. You want to sing them a song? Okay. But they ask us, and the question is, I have kids that cannot sing. And I have some kids that can sing. And we're going to talk about her in a minute. But here's what it is. It doesn't have to be, and I've learned this over time, some good buddies who've really just helped me with a lot of things would say, it's not, you don't have to be nice. You're worried about being nice. Too many people are worried about being nice when we should be focusing on kindness. Well, just be kind. Kind is being truthful without being hateful or mean or tearing someone down. But we're so worried about being nice that we never tell the person the actual truth. We just give them a half truth. Oh yeah, it was okay, you know. But then they get up in front of somebody like this and they meet a truth teller, like they meet a real one. And they walk away and they can be devastated because we didn't do our part to set them up well. We gotta get better at this. We have got to get better at this. Amen. You know, when I was, I'm gonna talk about her first. Yeah. Somebody said Jordan. I'll give one more example, and then we'll move. Yeah, she's awesome. We love Jordan. For those of you that know Jordan, that's my daughter. She sings up here. She plays bass. And we had this moment that encompasses this whole piece of scripture, and it was a beautiful thing. So Jordan, when we talk about being revered as such and respected as such, and what happens today, and especially in young people's life, but adults, we're not far behind. I think we do it too, is we start to look. We start to go, oh, well, they prayed like that, and they got some approval, so I'm going to start praying like them. And this person was on time and had their cables ready and their guitar tuned, and so I'm going to start, and this person over here did. And we start comparing our lives, and it becomes the looking glass of everything that we do. And it's all compared to an individual person or a thing that we would like to achieve. But here's where the rubber meets the road. Check this out. So Jordan, a couple months ago, I would say, maybe a month ago, a couple months ago, something like that, figured this out the hard way. So Jordan would have told you months ago, I'm a morning person. I get up. I am cheery when I wake up, and I get up to my first alarm, and I do all these things. This is what she would have said. If you're on this team, you know better. If you're on this team, you know better, and we love her to death. All the grace in the world, we love her to death. But if you're on this team, you know better. It's like, oh shoot, I'm late again. My alarm didn't go off. It's just weird. And here's what happens. If you're in our home, you know that when you're up at 4:30 in the morning having your coffee, that the alarm went off and she stopped it. And then the other alarm went off and she stopped that one too. Well, and then you go in her bedroom like, hey baby, time to get up. We've got church in an hour, and then do you have to work? Okay, I'm getting up, just like 5 more minutes, or yeah, okay. All right, cool, but I gotta go. I gotta leave now. And then she's late. And so we have this walk and talk moment, right? We have this walk and talk moment. And I just told her, I said, hey, listen, dad's been here. Every person has been here, I promise you. But this is what I have to tell you. You are holding yourself to a higher standard, and you're saying that you're something you're actually not. Because everyone in the home knows you're actually not a morning person. You actually shut your alarm off. You actually don't even remember me coming in your room. Like, and when you wake up, you're not in a good mood. Let's just be honest. You ain't in a good mood. You're like, nobody talk to me until I get my coffee. Like, so, and it's okay. This is what it took, you guys. Listen, it took her hearing that it's okay. It's okay. Why do you need to be known as a morning person? Who cares? So what? You stay up 3 hours later than anybody else when they're asleep at 9 o'clock. Nobody cares. But she cared because she saw it respected. Man, I'm going to be early because early is on time. And blah, blah. Are there some things you need to work on? Yes. But don't run after something that you're not just to win the approval of the people around you. That's actually not who you are. You're saying that's who you are, but that's not who you are. And she's a rock star. She actually went, you're going to love this. She went and, because me and Tess, we were like, what do we do? We're going in, we're helping her. She ordered one of the massive old alarm clocks. So she's got her phone and then this honking thing, like that the neighbors can hear. Like old school alarm clock. So she's doing it. She's like doing the steps to like get better at this thing that she wants to get better at. And it's super rad. As I was sitting down to do this message, how many parents do we have in the room? Yeah, raise your hand. Okay. I tried my hardest to get away from this. I was like, Jesus, this is not a Holy Spirit. This is not a message on parenting. Like, I just don't want to. But he wouldn't let the thought get out of my mind. And I'm like, man, what is it with parents? What is it with, and here's what it is. I'm going to give an example from my life in the past, so we don't pick on anybody here. I think that in ministry, in previous ministry, there's been some unhealthy moments and I would say seasons, even though I don't like that word, unhealthy seasons in ministry where people are trying to figure stuff out and leaders are trying to figure stuff out and there's people that hang in the balance. And I've been one of those people and I've been one of those leaders. What I found was, and this is what the Holy Spirit wanted me to say, is that I noticed in the unhealthy seasons when Tim would process all of the things that was happening, when he wouldn't start with Jesus and God's word, the things that we just talked about, here's what would happen. I would come home And I would talk about the things that made me the most unhappy about where I was. And this person doesn't understand. And you'd never believe that person acted that way and yada and all this stuff. And before you know it, I'm talking to my wife, processing with her, safe place. But the kids in the home hear the conversations that we have because I was a bozo and didn't think about maybe we should take a walk. Maybe we should go in private. Maybe we should. I'm home and I'm ready to unload. I'm ready just to talk to somebody that understands because nobody gets me right now. And what in that moment, I was deceiving myself because here's what happened. In the words that our kids hear us say in our homes when we come home, they're sponges and they soak it up. And what I found was I started to change the people in my home. I started to change their minds about something that they never had a bad experience in. And then when I was ready to move on, now I've got to go back and undo all of this stuff because they're not ready to come with me. And we've got to be careful. I just think if parents, if we get this thing right, where we don't just merely listen, but we do. And our starting place when stuff is rough is Jesus, is prayer, is the word of God. And then people that are also in those same things, not people outside of those things. It doesn't make any sense. I was processing with one of my buds, good friends, and he's going through a tough time. He doesn't live in the state. He's going through a tough time, and I know his family well, and he's like, yeah, dude, I was just processing with my mom, and you never believe it. I'm like, well, wait a minute. Why were you processing with your mom? Your mom, like, hates that stuff. Like, she doesn't, what are you doing? Don't you want to move and, like, heal through that? Don't you want to, she's just going to tell you what you want to hear. Like, she's not going to actually give you the work that you need to do to get yourself elevated, right? What are you doing? Process with the people that are in God's word, that are next to you, that when you look to your left and your right, you're running in the same direction at the same speed. Process with those people. But don't let that even be the first place you start. Let God's word and prayer be the first place that you start. Lastly, we'll read verse 26 here, and then we'll wrap up. 26. Those who consider themselves religious and yet do not keep a tight rein on their tongues deceive themselves, and their religion is worthless. Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. I started to try to unpack this, you know. I'm going to do the TKV, and there's no better way to say this. Like, I understand this just by reading this. Christ followers in this room, those of us that consider ourselves religious and yet allow this thing to fly off the handle, you deceive yourself. We deceive ourselves. And our religion is worthless. That hurts. Boy, if that's not a knife in the side, I don't know what is. Because haven't we all been there? Haven't we let our tongues fly? Come on, we can be honest. That religion is worthless. And then it goes on to say, okay, well, what is it then? Well, then what do you want me to do? Then what am I to do? If I get this under control, what am I to do? If I listen well and I don't speak and I listen to understand and not respond, but then I don't just listen, but I do what you tell me to do, what do you want me to do? And I believe that the Bible was an action plan for every one of us. I don't think it's something to read and just talk about, which I think is what James is trying to tell us. And the play is this: religion that our God accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. Agape City, I know it's tough. I promise you, I know it's tough. I have kids in school. We have seven of them. Half of them are in school. And I get it. I get what we're up against, I promise you. We fully understand what we're up against in this world today, not just in schools, in the workplace, just in general. We understand what we're up against, but here's where the mind shift is. Don't be fooled by the trap. This isn't the battle. This isn't even the real war. This isn't even our real home, if we're being honest. We're just passing through. And oh, to get this right while we're passing through. And maybe if we get it right, some people will come with us that weren't with us before. What do you say? When I read this, I don't know about you, but I think a lot of times when we read scripture, when we read the Bible, depending on our feelings, which we cannot trust, our emotions, which we still cannot trust, I think that we look at stuff like this as an option. Well, I mean, if I want to be extra spiritual that week, maybe I'll go and we start talking about stuff. Well, maybe I'll. Religion that God, our Father, accepts as pure and faultless as this. You look after the ones that don't have mom and dads. That's what you do. And you don't have a choice. That's the beautiful thing about the Word of God. When you say, we just had a guy last service, Mike, one of the coolest dudes, man, I got to meet. He said, now's the time. He was baptized. And that's it for him. He said, yeah, I used to get the Savior thing because he did all that. I get it. But I want him to be my Lord now. And that's all on me. He went to the cross as the Savior, but I want him as Lord of my life to take the reins, and I want to do everything he tells me to do. There is no choice. Jesus followers, this is what we will do. We will love those who don't have parents. We will be there for those that are in distress. And it all costs all of the things that are celebrated, that are applauded, that are lived out right in front of us. James is saying, keep yourself from them. Don't fall for it. Don't be polluted. Don't be polluted. Stay here. Stick with me. And so what does it mean for you and I? What is James really trying to get through to us in this first week of this series? And I think it's this. That maybe for a season, we need to put some blinders on. You know, a lot of us, we think of blinders as a bad thing. Well, no, I need to see everything. When I think of blinders, when they put them on a horse, that horse is hyper-focused on the only thing that's in front of it. Not what's on its left, not what's on its right, not what's behind it, but what's straight ahead. And I think that what James is trying to get us to do is let God's word be the looking glass that we view our lives through, and a people to become a people that reveal his kingdom wherever we are, whatever community we're in, whatever relationships we're in, at our work, at our school, at our job, at whatever it is. I think that's what he's trying to get us to do by listening and doing. We got to do both. And man, I'm telling you, oh, to get this. If we get both of these right, immediate change will happen in your home. I promise you. We've seen it ourselves. Immediate change will happen in your home, in the world around you, for the better. And you know the one thing that's holding you back from that? You can say it out loud. If you know the answer, what's the one thing that would be holding us back from this? Say it louder. Somebody said it. You and me. You and me. One of my favorite TST meetings, and I promise we're wrapping up. Hey, Brad does it, I get to do it too. No. One of my favorite meetings, TST so far, Brad had said something that, and he was just repeating scripture, but it was just that like aha moment, you know? It was the, oh man, I've never thought of it that way. And here's what he said. We were walking through stuff. We were walking through peace and grace and mercy and all the things, like the fruit of the Spirit that we want to, you know? And he said, as much as it depends on you, fill in the blank. Read the Bible that way. Don't read the Bible for, oh man, I can't wait to go tell this person about this stuff so they can shape up. Nope. May your feet be fitted with peace as much as it depends on you. Not anybody else's reactions. May your words give life to people as much as it depends on you, regardless of what happens, regardless of of how people take it, regardless of, as much as it depends on you. Fill in the blank, because you are the thing that stands in front of the mirror. Ain't nobody else with you. It's just you. And so may we take the word of God and it become the mirror over and through and in our lives. So what's at stake? Everything. Souls, hearts, minds, people, families. What have we been given to succeed? Everything. And the time is now. Man, this message is for today. Don't miss it, church.